So we'll begin this morning with a presentation on great compassion, Maha Karuna, with Dr. John Dunne. Thank you.
Oh, good morning, everybody. Our ranks have thinned a little. Sunday morning. The party animals aren't up yet, I guess. So, or else no one cares about compassion. No. That can't be. So I'm going to talk to you a little bit about compassion. This is not the best title, actually, in terms of describing what I'm going to talk about. It will certainly cover all that. Compassion, I just want to say as a sort of preface, is a really hot topic these days. It's interesting how I'm working with a few different people. One of them is Paul Condon at Northeastern, whose study was on the effects of loving kindness meditation, was recently in the press. And Paul and I and Larry Barslew and some other people are working on an article on compassion that looks at it from different perspectives, both in terms of Andy Dreitzer is a theologian at the Claremont Theological School, I think it's called, I can't remember quite, and he's doing a Christian perspective, I'm doing a Buddhist perspective, Paul and some others are working on a scientific perspective. And one of the things we've noticed is in the culture it's really become a kind of meme. It has emerged over the last decade or two in a way that is much more prominent than it was previously. And it's a hot topic even for those of us in Buddhist studies. Interestingly, there is no significant academic work on compassion within Buddhism. That should tell you something, actually, about its location within Buddhism. And there will be, presumably soon, but so far there is not. So if you want to find an academic work that goes through some of the stuff I'm going through today, you can't. There isn't one. How's that for surprising? And that's not because academics have been ignoring compassion. It's because compassion has become more important than it has been. It's always there, it's always been important, but it's become highlighted in a way that it was not highlighted previously. And some of that is cultural conditions. Some of it is maybe because we need it right now more than any other time, kind of in a global sense. Some of it is the work of His Holiness the Dalai Lama and the way in which compassion is a kind of meeting ground for all of us and his insight into that. So part of that preface means that it's important for us to kind of really keep track of what compassion is for and what it is. And even though there's a way in which we can kind of, it can become, when things are cultural memes, we can start to just flag wave and get very excited about them and forget and not know any of the details. Kind of get carried away with the meme itself. So we'll try to be clear about what is compassion, what is loving kindness, because they are not the same, and they are not the same practices. What is the role of compassion and loving kindness, and what forms of compassion are there, and how is compassion cultivated in meditation practice? Those are going to be our topics for today. So first of all, what is compassion? It is the Sanskrit word for compassion is karuna. And as Rinpoche pointed out, one of the sort of fanciful etymologies, as on Friday we had a discussion, and one of the fanciful etymologies for the word karuna is that it means in Sanskrit, kamrunadhi, taking its first syllable ka, and then the last two syllables runa, but in a short a, and putting them together as if it came originally from the phrase kam runadhi, which means it stops runadhi, kam, which means here a happiness or pleasure. So interestingly, this fanciful etymology is saying that compassion is something that inhibits pleasure, not somebody else's pleasure, but in a sense your own pleasure. So there's a sense that compassion is connected to an empathic connection with the of someone else's suffering. And that's a key way of understanding compassion. It's this empathic connection that's an affective state that then yearns for another to be free of suffering. Right? So it starts from that empathic resonance with the suffering of another and then seeks to end that suffering. Loving kindness is in Sanskrit Maitri, which is actually, some of you may know the Greek gods. My daughter loves the Percy Jackson series, for example, and you might know of Mithra, right? This is from the same word, same root, same Indo-European root, Mitra, which means friendship, a friend. So Maitri means friendliness, actually, literally. And it's an affective state that yearns for another to be happy, but not by virtue of resonating with pain. Compassion is resonance with pain. And friendliness seems to be more about resonance with kind of identification with the other, where you would extend your sense, your own natural urge to be happy is sort of extended to the other because you identify with the other. Right? So that's an important distinction, not clearly thematized in Buddhism. The first part is the resonance with pain, but this notion of the sort of resonance with the other or through identification is more implicit than explicit. Anyway, what is compassion for? One of the things, as I say, as a cultural mean, we can kind of think that the whole end point of compassion is that the point is compassion. The point of Buddhist practice is compassion, and that it's kind of all one big Buddha stew, compassion, loving kindness, you know, it's all. But actually, compassion and loving kindness are distinct in important ways. As we just saw, they're defined differently. They involve different kinds of empathic resonance. And even though it often occurs with loving kindness and is cultivated with loving kindness, it should not be confused with it. Early Buddhism and Theravada, even in contemporary terms, there's much more emphasis on loving kindness or Maitri. And what Maitri does is actually it's protective. So the traditional metta bhavana, the cultivation of loving kindness, it is said that it was developed to help meditators who are meditating in challenging areas, as they often were meant to do out in the wilderness and so on, in the forests, to deal with fear. So metta bhavana was an antidote to fear. Also, it is seen to be the antidote to anger, metta bhavana. So it was set up as a kind of specific practice you did in order to deal with certain kinds of issues that were blocking you from your main practice, which of course is shamatha and vipassana, right? Mental quiescence and insight. So metta bhavana is really, in contemporary Theravada Buddhism and in Western Buddhism, has now become a sort of main practice for people. Probably that was not the case previously. Probably. In Mahayana, compassion, not a Maitri, but compassion, not loving kindness, but compassion, is necessary for the full achievement of awakening or Buddhahood. So compassion is instrumental to the achievement of Buddhahood. It is not an end in itself. So when we see Shanti Deva's famous text, The Guide to the Bodhisattva's Way of Life, and the Guide to the Bodhisattva's Way of Life, the ninth chapter, which is about wisdom, says that in order to achieve this kind of wisdom, you need all of the other perfections. And that's what they're for. They are angas, they are yenla, they are auxiliaries for the achievement of wisdom. And of course, the last perfection before wisdom is the perfection of meditation or concentration, but that chapter in Bodhisattva, in Shantideva's text, is all about the cultivation of compassion. So compassion is an instrument to the achievement of wisdom. Now, that doesn't mean that compassion isn't very important and wonderful and actually essential. It's just that it's very important to see that the way in which the tradition locates compassion is that it is for something else. It is not actually an end in itself. interestingly enough. That sort of shifts a little bit, I think, some of the way it works as a cultural meme, is we can, in the way that it's been sort of spreading in our culture, is there's a sense in which, oh, it's all about compassion, you know, the Beatles, or love is all you need. And actually, love is not all you need. You have to have wisdom. And compassion is for wisdom. Now, what's very interesting about that idea, which we won't go into in great detail, is the notion that you can have wisdom without compassion, but it's always going to be limited. The only way to get the highest level of wisdom is to have compassion. That's a very interesting idea. And that actually makes compassion extremely important, right? Because in the technical way this is discussed for you, sort of students of Buddhist philosophy and such, is that that there are two obscurations that have to be overcome in order to become a Buddha, the so-called dripni in Tibetan, or the two avarana in Sanskrit. And one of them is called, we often translate it as the cognitive obscuration, the jnaya avarana, an obscuration that obstructs your awareness of that which is to be known. And the only way you can achieve this overcoming of full awakening is to reorient yourself away from self-centeredness. It's closely related to self-centeredness, even closely related to a kind of fixed sense of subjectivity. And you might even say an incapacity to truly take the perspective of another. In other words, that one way of thinking about this is that this obscuration is the incapacity to not just intellectually understand, but experience the fact that there are multiple realities, in a sense. That there are the beings around you all have perspectives, and in a sense are all sort of constituting a reality with you from within that perspective. And the incapacity to see that their reality is somehow just as real as your reality, experientially, to sort of see through somebody's eyes, is, on my view, kind of caught up with this obscuration that blocks you from real full awakening. Right? So how are you going to get rid of that fundamental self-centeredness, like locked into your own perspective? The only way to do that is through compassion. Compassion does that. It reorients the mind out of that being locked into your own perspective. It's a kind of, so in a way, it's sort of, we're talking about a kind of perspective taking, but perspective taking on a truly experiential level. So it not only does it do this, then there are other reasons they say, and I won't go through all the details, but basically it provides enough motivation or energy even, a kind of jazzed up mind state that is necessary for this sort of realization of wisdom. And it replaces ignorance as the creative force that produces the Buddha field. So what drives samsara is ignorance. Right? The world of suffering is driven by ignorance. The sort of nirvanic world in Mahayana is called the Buddha Kshetra, the Buddha field. It's kind of, you know, post-enlightenment samsara, is samsara after transformation. Because the new model in Mahayana is, it's nirvana is not cessation, it's transformation. So what's that new world? What in a sense drives it is compassion. This is actually formally, this is something that you see within ritual structures and tantric rituals, for example. And finally, compassion is the only way to be truly happy, which maybe is the reason that most of us really would resonate with. But this is the reason why, right? Which is a very interesting little verse from Shantideva, the great author on the Bodhisattva's way of life. Ye kechit sukita loke te sarve swasukhe chaya. Ye kechit sukita loke sarve tenya sukhe chaya. All those who are unhappy in the world are so, they're unhappy, because they desire their own happiness. This, by the way, does not align very well with some of our current cultural ways of talking about this stuff. All those who are happy in the world are so because they desire others to be happy. We're going to talk. We're going to go back to some of that non-alignment soon. I'm sure you know what I'm talking about, some of you, right? This first sentence in particular some of us would think as being as dysfunctional. It's like you're not taking care of yourself. You have to have self-compassion. We're going to come back to that. So there are forms of compassion. And we went over some of these actually on Friday. It's one way of talking about different kinds of compassion is that there's compassion that has different levels of insight connected to it, basically different levels of wisdom. You can have compassion for people, beings, persons, individual persons. But at the next level, you can know and experience that persons are actually just bundles of fizzing elements. Mental and physical elements. They're just bundles of elements. So you don't have compassion for Serena, you have compassion for the bundle of elements that we call Serena. Just as, there's just as much emotion. It's not like it's somehow not as good if it's not for a person. It's better if it's not for a person. Because the person, the name person, obscures the fact that what you're actually dealing with is a fizzing, changing bundle of elements. Like if, I use the word Serena, then I expect Serena to be exactly the same today as she was tomorrow, or yesterday. What am I talking about? I have a cold, so little incoherence is acceptable today. If I wake up next to somebody today, and then I say, I expect her, I wake up next to Anna today, and then the next day I wake up next to Anna, and I expect Anna to be exactly the same, because it's Anna, obviously, but the fizzing bundle of elements are not the same. They're changing every day, every moment. Right? So that's where you really want to have compassion. That's a more insightful level of compassion. And then there can be an even further level of compassion, which is what they call objectless. This is difficult to articulate, but it is essentially, in a sense, seeing that even that notion of a bundle of elements is ultimately not the case. You can't ultimately say that. Even that account is what that person really is. Right? So then there's another way of talking about compassion, which is basically partial compassion or parochial compassion, limited compassion. This is compassion for one's family and in-group, right? For your kin. This is the kind of compassion that we see in mammals or in other non-human primates, for example, in the great apes, a sort of spontaneous connection, spontaneous empathic resonance with the suffering of others and an urge to help. We see that a lot in non-human primates, and if you're interested in that type of material, I highly recommend Franz de Waal's work, including The Age of Empathy and The Bonobo and the Atheist, his latest two books, where he goes through a lot of the evidence for the notion that non-human primates and other mammals have this. It's just we naturally resonate empathically with others and also have helping behaviors, altruistic behaviors, essentially compassionate behaviors. But it's very specific to in-group or kin in the vast majority of cases, those you identify with, right? And then there's impartial compassion, or if you like, limitless compassion, right? Compassion for all beings, no in-group, out-group distinction. Or perhaps everybody's in your in-group. Everybody's part of your family. And we can say it's compassion on top of that, then there's a compassion with a special intention, which is not only this sort of based on a kind of resonance with the suffering of the other, a wish for the other to be free of suffering, but now an actual commitment to do that yourself. This is compassion with a special intention, the avasaya. And that's what leads to the state of mind, which is called bodhicitta, that is the cause of Buddhahood. That's what you need in order to achieve that highest level of awakening. Okay, so this is the kind of compassion. In a way, it's built on all of these, but this is the one that matters. So what's left out is self-compassion. Now, one, this is a challenging idea because this is also a very prominent cultural meme, and I think even Serena will be talking about it, but it's very important to note that this is not a traditional term in Buddhism. I have heard some speakers say, at various meetings I've heard people say, self-compassion is the essence of Buddhism. That's really false. That's just not true. There are maybe good reasons for that, that we have a certain notion of self-compassion within our culture, and that notion of self-compassion is really connected to issues around self-loathing that we have. But self-loathing is a very difficult concept, actually, to construe in Buddhism. When His Holiness the Dalai Lama in the 90s at a meeting, and Sharon Salzberg was there and has told me about that, and Pema Chodron has an account of this on her webpage somewhere. When he first heard of the idea that there were Westerners, it was a meeting with Western Dharma teachers, that there were Westerners, and they were meeting in Dharamsala, and then, they had a lot of time. There were Westerners who hated themselves, basically, who had self-loathing, who felt like they did not deserve to be happy. He said, no, there aren't. And then the back and forth was essentially, what are you talking about? That's just not possible. And then finally, he came to accept the idea that there were some people who perceived themselves to be in that state. Now, from a Buddhist standpoint, there is an explanation of that, or there is a way of talking about it, but the response to it is not compassion. Because that's actually just an oxymoron. Compassion is always other-centered. Compassion is about responding to it. You have to have self-other distinction in order to have compassion. The only way you can have self-compassion is if you make yourself into an object, and a lot of self-compassion practices work like this, which is part of the reason they may not be so good. Is you have to make yourself into an object and kind of objectify yourself and then have compassion for yourself. But one of the ways of understanding the issue of self-loathing is that it's precisely based on this objectification of self and then a mismatch between who you think you're supposed to be and what you perceive. Right? So that whole objectification process could be seen as the root of the problem here. So doing more of that probably isn't going to help. So there is a way, though, you can talk about self-compassion. And my colleague, Geshe Losan Tenzin, and also Geshe Thupten Jinpa, who have both developed compassion, secularized compassion protocols, have recognized that this is something we have to do. We have to deal with. I mean, this is a fact in Western culture, in our culture, especially American culture. It's not as prominent in Europe. But in American culture, this is a big issue. This kind of self-loathing may come from this sort of mismatch between who we think we should be and who we are. After all, and as they say in Lake Wobegon, all the children are above average. by the way, is an oxymoron in case. Right? So if everyone is supposed to be above average, and you have, that's the self-image you have, and then you see who you are, there's going to be a mismatch. Right, so that kind of cultural trend in the United States may be one of the factors that has led to this problem in our culture. It is not a universal problem. There is something that addresses it. And so my colleagues, like Geshe Losan Tenzin, who's developed cognitive-based compassion training, recognize that we do have to address this, no question. This is not to in any way, this is a reality. Most of us have at least a little of this. And there's no point in pretending we don't have it. So how do we address it? There is a way of talking about compassion, self-compassion, and they will even use the term self-compassion, but what they're translating is the technical term for renunciation. Renunciation is the recognition, or ngenjung in Tibetan, is the recognition, first of all, that you suffer. You have to, first of all, recognize your suffering. And then recognize, on the basis of that suffering, there is an urge to remove your suffering. Now, the blockage here, of course, comes when you recognize your suffering and you think, I deserve it. I'm being punished or whatever it is. I'm supposed to suffer. But the claim is, in this context especially of enunciation, that there's a part of you, natural aspect of your mind, that simply seeks to avoid suffering. And that's what one seeks to tap into. That this natural urge for all beings, all sentient beings, indeed you can define sentience by approaching happiness and avoiding suffering. And that is not conceived of as a problem in this context. There's nothing wrong with wanting to be happy. And there is nothing wrong with wanting to avoid suffering. That's the basis of the whole practice. Right? So that's, so obviously there's work that needs to be done here, especially around those notions of self-image and notions of, you know, deserving to be unhappy and so on and so forth. But thinking of it in these terms is probably much more helpful, rather than objectifying yourself, but rather sort of recognizing within yourself your own natural urges to be happy and valorizing those. All right, I won't go on any more about this. It's a very fascinating topic, and there's not a lot of work on it yet, but we're getting there. I just wanted to say the last thing, though, that whole issue of objectification, self-objectification, that leads to self-loathing actually does have a technical location within the Buddhist literature and is considered a form of pride. So what, interestingly enough, so one of the forms of pride is, I am the best in the world. And another form of pride is, I am the worst in the world. Interestingly enough. Why? Because they're based on this same kind of mechanism of objectification and assessment at sort of the extremes of the spectrum. Very interesting. My colleague Maria Heim has written an article about this. This is especially clear in the Pali Abhidhamma. Okay, so on we go. Cultivating compassion. Note that loving kindness meditation is not compassion meditation. This is actually something that gets a little conflated in some existing protocols, even ones I've been kind of involved in terms of scientific studies. So we'll conflate these, compassion meditation and loving kindness meditation, in part because Western teachers do that. And I'm not saying that's illegitimate. It's just if we're really trying to understand the origins of the training and how they are based on theoretical accounts, we want to keep them clearly separate, at least in terms of our analyses, right? If it's helpful to combine the different types of practice together, then one should obviously do that. Loving kindness meditation, or metta bhavana, is a meditation, for example, that does actually begin with yourself. Traditionally, so you actually send love, not compassion. You fill yourself with love, with Maitri, and then extend it outward. This, you do not do this in compassion meditation, because you can't. It's not, again, what compassion means is always about others. So that is a one distinction. And if you look at the actual, I'm not going to go through the actual practices right now in detail, but if you look at the actual practices, you will see that they're very distinct. So cultivating compassion, basically there's sort of a bottom-up, what in using cognitive scientific terms you could call a bottom-up and a top-down process in compassion. One of them is a bottom-up kind of process that is called the sevenfold cause and effect, or the Gyundre Mingha Dun, that taps into some innate capacities for compassion that we've already referred to. It's bottom up in the sense that you trigger your innate empathic response to those you identify to be in your in-group. You trigger that and it just arises. You don't have to do anything. You don't have to think about it. You just actually trigger it even without thought. You trigger it with visualization. right? So it's just, you're given the stimulus and naturally you have this response. Okay, so that's the bottom-up process. The top-down process, so, you know, chimpanzees have that. Bonobos have that. You can trigger it in them. One of the ways they trigger it, actually, one of the bases of this type of empathic response is yawning. So if you show a chimpanzee a video of another chimp yawning,
anyone feeling a little urge?
Yes, yeah, you do, don't you? So that's interesting. The yawn is one of the main, like, just empathic triggers. And bonobos and... everyone's, I'm not going to yawn. And interestingly, on top of it, the chimpanzee is much more, or bonobo is much more likely to yawn if the chimpanzee in the video is one they know. Which is why you're not yawning back at me, because I'm not in your in-group, apparently. That guy, he's the enemy. He says there's no self-compassion. Right? So it's that resonance, so that kind of empathic resonance, you just stimulate. You don't have to think about it. You just present the stimulus and bango, it happens. So top down is where you're thinking. And this is what, you know, bonobos and chimpanzees can't do. Where we actually then use the rational aspect of our mind, you know, perhaps the prefrontal cortex, and kind of using what scientists will call, and Serena can say much more about this, is, you know, kind of executive control to take offline the in-group, out-group distinction. Right? And to bring everyone into our in-group. So those are the two processes, and that's through exchange of self and other. And they are both, there's a great starting in chapter 11 of this book called The Path to Bliss. It's actually been around a long time. There's a wonderful description. Hope you can see that. The Path to Bliss by His Holiness the Dalai Lama. Wonderful description of these styles of practice. So I'm not going to go through them in detail. One important preliminary to the practice itself for both of those practices that are actually combined, they technically come from different lineages. The can we go back? I can go back, right? Here. The sevenfold cause and effect is said to come from Maitreya through a Sangha. The top-down exchange of self and other found in Shantideva's text is said to come from Manjushri through Shantideva. But actually, they are, in practice, they are combined. But both of them start with an important preliminary, which is a focus on equanimity. And basically, is the way His Holiness talks about this, and I should stop soon, is appreciating our common humanity in this specific way. We all want to be happy, and nobody wants to suffer. Right? And that is sort of the thing to embrace that is very important for this practice. And obviously that's also sort of the antidote to the self-loathing, which is we all want to be happy and nobody wants to suffer. We might think we deserve to suffer, but we don't want to. Right? Unless we're that, what is that book by Dan Brown, you know? What? Yeah, what is it called again? The Da Vinci Code with the monk who's like, no, we're not flagellants. We do not want to, right? We don't want to suffer. We may think we deserve it, but we don't want to. That's the thing that's happened. Okay? Everyone wants to be happy. Nobody wants to suffer. And that makes us universe, that's our all common humanity. And of course, it's really common to all sentient beings. In fact, in a sense, that is what it means to be conscious. That's what consciousness is built around in a certain way. And then this kind of equanimity then aids in the bottom-up generation of compassion through identification, because once you have that sense, I am just like others. They want to be happy, they don't want to suffer. They may be idiots about how they go about it. They may hurt me because they think it will make them happy, but they're not doing that because they want to hurt me, they're doing that because they want to be happy. So everyone is on your side. Some of them may be very confused about how to do this. But so basically no one has a negative intention. They're just stupid. Right? They're muddha. Right? So you don't have to distrust anybody's intention. Everybody's trying to be happy and everyone's trying to avoid suffering, and some of us are really confused about how to do that. We're all confused about how to do it, right? But we're all in that same boat. So this very much helps in that empathic identification with others. And then it also is the basis for the Tao-Tan elimination of the distinction between in-group and out-group. And I'll just tell you a quick tale here, and then I should stop, which is Thupten Jinpa, the translator of His Holiness, is also a very accomplished scholar on his own. He's been working with Stanford University in the development of a compassion protocol similar to the cognitive-based compassion protocol, compassion training developed at Emory by my colleague Gishi Lozon Tenzin and a couple of my students. And he's been trying this. One of our researchers at Emory is about to try this on veterans as well. But he's been working with a group of veterans with PTSD, post-traumatic stress disorder, which is a very difficult to treat. And they have reported, they haven't published anything on this yet, but he's reported that one of the things that has worked for them unbelievably well, that they've actually turned into a kind of mantra, which is not traditional in the practice, but they've kind of taken this part of the practice and turned into a mantra, is that when they find themselves starting to get angry, and one of the ways in PTSD can manifest is you get really impatient with situations and with people. And anger can arise very easily. And what he says these vets have started saying is they start to notice that, right, which is part of the training, noticing. And then they say, just like me. Like there's this person that's really just annoying them, right? Injustice can trigger this, actually, it's a perception of injustice. Like that person is cutting in line. Right? But instead of getting angry, they think, oh, well, they're not doing it because they want to be mean. They're doing it because they want to be happy and they don't want to suffer. Just like me. Right? Just like me. Just like me. So that's a top-down. So this just like me, which is really in what equanimity is about, works for the bottom-up purpose, but that's also a real case of a top-down use. It's kind of a new mengok, actually. It's like a new special instruction. These short phrases that Chanti Deva has, some of them. One of my favorites is, if there's something you can do about it, why get upset? If there's nothing you can do about it, why get upset? That's a good one. And this is a new one. It's like, just like me. Right? Everyone wants to be happy. No one wants to suffer. So the steps of the sevenfold cause and effect, you can read about it in Path to Bliss, so I won't go through it in really great detail. It's distinct from loving kindness meditation, but you recognize all beings as your mothers, and there's always somebody when in the past I've translated for lamas, including Rinpoche, but I don't think this ever happened when I translated for Rinpoche, but someone will go through this, talk about this step. Recognize all sentient beings as your mothers, and this is actually meant literally based on multi-lives, but also there are more metaphorical interpretations in some Indian texts. In any case, there's always someone in the audience at the end who stands up and says, but I hate my mother. And then the lama falls on the floor and like, take me back to Tibet. These people are crazy. Really, it's like, wow, that's a strange thing to think. Again, very cultural perspective. His Holiness Dalai Lama has commented on this and said, yes, actually in Tibet we have bad mothers too. So, but the idea is to find someone, and you do this in visualization. You've done that equanimity. Everyone wants to be happy. Nobody wants to suffer. You've tried to even out the classes of beings, in-group, out-group, right? Enemies, friends, neutral people. You try to even them all out, and then you start this process visualizing someone that you have this automatic empathic response to, right? Who's a benefactor, someone who has aided you. Someone who did this for you when you, the reason they choose the mother in particular is what's great about the mother is you had, if the, your mother didn't take care of you, if someone didn't do the mothering, you'd be dead. And there was no reason to mother you. It's not like, you know, you were paying them. In fact, you were depriving them of sleep and pooping everywhere, throwing up, crying, looking cute, it's true, but... Then you recall all that kindness, and then there's a sense of repaying kindness, and the repayment of the kindness is not based on an argument. Based, in other words, this is not a rational process. This is all triggering innate stuff. When they say you want to repay the kindness that's been done to you, the text, when they talk about this, don't say, because, you know, this is, in order to live in a proper society, everyone has to exhibit reciprocity. Reciprocity is also observed in primates, other primates. Rather, basically the texts say, wouldn't you be a jerk if you didn't? Meaning it's just tapping into this sense that this is the way, sort of spontaneously, how we feel, that when someone does this for us, we just want to help in return, that reciprocity. And then you do cultivate loving kindness here, but you do that as an aid to cultivating compassion. Focusing on the suffering of the mothers. Very, very vivid visualization sometimes about the suffering. And then finally you get the special attitude, which is not just... So we've already... This is universalized. This is not because you're seeing all beings as your mother. You've already done the equanimity practice previously. You've brought everyone into your in-group. So compassion here is really going to be great compassion, limitless compassion for all beings. Because they're all your family. Right? In some Indian texts, they don't use mother, they use father, cousin, brother, sister, depending on how old the person is and so on, who you're visualizing. Just someone you have that strong, immediate empathic connection with. And then you develop the special attitude, which is distinct, to the Mahayana, to the form of Buddhism that reaches Tibet, which is, I'm going to do it myself. Not only do I want this to be the case, but I'm going to see to it that it happens. And that's a key to development, to the arrival then of the result. These are the six step causes, and that's the seventh step, the result, which is bodhicitta, the cause of Buddhahood. So very quickly then, and then after that you'd do the exchange of self and other. Just very quickly, so I just want to repeat, I know, I'm sorry to keep sending this message, but compassion is not directed at the self. It is cultivated primarily by tapping into an innate capacity for empathy and altruism. Its rational argument is not useful for that purpose. That's the bottom-up part. You just stimulate visualization, stories, narratives, not argument. But rational argument is key to eliminating the in-group, out-group distinction, right, which blocks us from having empathy and compassion for others. Thank you very much. Yun ring bo shi are sha kunda Sorry, I hope that wasn't too long.
No, is there a question or two for John about his presentation for Dr. Dunne? Yes.
I'm curious how you see the relationship between what you just talked about and narcissism.
Well, I think, yes, I think, I mean, my own view, so I'll just very briefly say that the issue of self-loathing and depression coming out of that sort of self-loathing is one of the findings, and Serena knows this better than me, I'm sure, is that many forms of depression also correlate with high self-focus. where you basically think about yourself a lot. So one study accidentally, in fact, was they were collecting data on heart patients, and they were doing random audio sampling, and then they examined the samples later, and then one thing they just happened upon is that the people who scored high on depression measures also used the first person pronoun the most. Whether I or me, interestingly enough. So that kind of excessive self-focus seems to correlate with unhappiness, which was what Shantideva was saying. And I want to be happy. And I think we have developed culturally in that direction, which is part of the reason we have this issue, more than Europe, right? Is that the sort of excessive self-focus of our culture is leading to more and more problems in this area. So just, you know, dropping the excessive self-focus and allowing the natural spontaneous sense of, there is a natural spontaneous self-focus that can also be seen as a sort of problem in the Buddhist context, but that is something we know how to work with, right? Which is, I want to be happy and I don't want to suffer. There's, you know, that is the basis for the practice, right? The noble truth, the truth of first noble truth, the truth of suffering, really, if you say, there is suffering, and then you say, and I deserve it, that kind of, you know, the story's over. You don't need any more truths. But yes, it's a very good point. It's narcissism. We have a very narcissistic culture. An excellent point.
Could it be also related to, like you said, it's more predominant here than in Europe. Could it be related to a modern imperial attitude of the U.S. Having a chasm between how long the country is in our side and all this narrative, as opposed to the atrocities that we have to commit. So there is that chasm in there.
The sort of disconnect between, that's an interesting, I think a lot of it is about, certainly what I would say is that the sort of, the style of, and this is, by the way, not just the U.S. that has been complicit in this, making the U.S. into the policeman and the great center of the Western world. I mentioned the Percy Jackson series. I don't know if any of your kids are reading those, where the Greek gods have moved from Rome to the U.S. because now we're the head of the West, which I found really hilarious. But that sort of image that we're the home of Olympus is part of the issue, yes, that we have this, which much of the world has been complicit in, right? And of course, we've happily taken it. But I think it's also very much the general trend in modernity that gets exacerbated in the U.S. culture is the sort of turn towards subjectivity and an alienation of the subject from its larger location within, the alienation of the person as a subject from a larger location within society. So, you know, subjects, persons are much more integrated into cultural frameworks, into social frameworks in traditional societies. So that sort of alienation, the nomadism, urban nomadism, and so on.
Sense of helplessness too.
Yes, also being right, that you're like, you're just part of the matrix, and it's the machine is running, and you can't do anything about it. All of that, those are a series of problems. It's a complex issue. Which I don't think anyone has really quite explored in writing yet. Yes, Mark.
John, are you suggesting that my tweeting 400 times a day and telling everybody everything I'm thinking, feeling, and doing is not compassionate?
It depends. Is it entertaining?
I hope so.
You know, interesting thing, I'm just completely off topic and we should get moving because I took too long, but we do that, right? We Americans, maybe again, a little bit more than many Europeans, we talk about our feelings and emotions. You know who never talks about their emotions at all and don't have a word for emotion? But also, I had a student in Dharamsala, I was in Dharamsala recently, who did sort of facial recognition of emotion using Paul Ekman's famous protocol. And with Tibetans, And they were asked to recognize emotions, and they were not very good at it. And they were asked to produce emotions, and there was one series of pictures that is hilarious. Show us surprise. Show us happiness. There was one. And the other set of pictures was a monkey. Show us surprise. Show us happiness. Show us anger. It was great. It was so great. It's like they're the opposite. They don't talk about their emotions at all. Motivator. Yeah, Tibetans just like, you know, how are you feeling today? Are you okay? I'm feeling a little sort of, you know, down and sad. They're like, you actually can't really even say that in Tibetan.
In the language.
Yeah, it's really hard. You can say I'm feeling down, and you can definitely say those things, mm-hmm. but like complex emotional reports, especially in colloquial conversation, you really can't do.